It should be observed, also, that there are not a few very obscure and perplexing passages in these pseudo-sibyllines, and in some verses one cannot best only guess at the meaning. There are also numerous lacunae and mutilations in all existing manuscripts, as, for example, at the conclusion of Book 12. These are indicated in the translation just as they appear in the printed Greek texts. In the few plus where a list of proper names occurs and English rhythm is impossible, my only course was simply to transfer the names in the order in which they stand in the Greek. The task of the translator is at the present rather to accept the order of the books as they appear in all the printed texts of the Greek original. The fact that many of the early Christian fathers cited these pseudonymous oracles as veritable holy scripture gives the work an importance in biblical criticism and theology which justifies the attention uno have given the matter. Sapoesse poems are written in Aeolian Greek, spoken in antiquity in the northeastern Aegean. This is a rustic and more archaic dialect than the Attic or New Testament Greek which is typically taught in schools, closer to the Homeric. Indeed, many of the confirmed surviving Sappho fragments are from quotes in Roman grammatical treatises to illustrate fine points of the Aeolic dialect. The early Christians burned most of her poems, but couldn't eradicate every stray line of hers that was quoted in some textbook. In some cases the Sappho fragments are references in text to quotes in other lost texts. Beginning with the generation first of mortal men down to the very last ill prophesied thing, what erst has been, and what is now, and what shall yet befall the world through the impiety of men. First now God urges on me to relate truly how into being came the world, and do, shrewd mortal, prudently make known, lest ever do shouldest my commands neglect, the King Most High, who brought into existence the whole world, saying, let there be, and there was. For he there established, placing it round about Tartarus, and himself. At a previous time Tartarus, the prison of the Titans, is here conceived as encompassed by the earth and forming its interior. Hesiod represents it as surrounded by a brazen fence and situated as far beneath the earth as earth gave the sweet light, he raised the heaven on high, spread out the gleaming sea, and crowned the sky with an abundance of bright shining stars, and decked the earth with plants, and mingled sea with rivers, and therewith zephyrs mixed and watery clouds, and then, another race appointing, he gave fishes to the seas, and birds unto the winds, and to the woods the beasts of shaggy neck, and snakes that crawl, and all things which now on the earth appear.